Okay, good morning. So this lecture is not about stuff which was discussed 20 years ago, which was so far the lectures which I presented, but it's now connecting to what current research in this area is about. So this is an example of techniques which you have seen in the first two lectures being boosted up to current research. Now, what is current research about? I talked about briefly in the very first lecture about this phenomenon of many-body localization. That's the claim of physicists that this phenomenon of Anderson localization, which is clearly a one-particle phenomenon, survives the onset of interactions. Okay, and as I said, this is kind of remarkable, because what this entails in particular is that you can prepare experiments as they are done in Munich by Bloch's group, where you have atoms in a cavity and you put all the atoms to the left half of the cavity. Then you release the wall in between the cavity. The cavity has a random potential before those atoms, which in Bloch's experiment is just laser light. And you will see somehow that most of the atoms will remain in the left half of the cavity. So something which statistical mechanics actually would, by its very foundational hypothesis, forbid. Okay, now, so that's the phenomenon which physicists try to understand. There's a very sort of minor contribution where we can actually say something. Now, what are interacting systems? In physics, somehow the easiest interacting systems which you can look at are actually spin chains. And since we're dealing with quantum mechanics, we want to look at quantum spin chains. Now, what is a quantum spin chain? So what you envision is a line of length 2L plus 1. And on each of the vertex segments of this line, you attach a Hilbert space. The easiest non-trivial Hilbert space you can attach is C2. And in this C2 somehow represents the Hilbert space of a so-called quantum spin 1/2. Okay? So quantum spin 1/2 comes with a set of operators which represent measurable observables for these for this quantum spin 1/2 particle. And they happen to be the generators of the rotation group, namely the Pauli matrices. So in the particular representation where the third Pauli matrix is actually diagonal, these Pauli matrices are written on the slide above. Now, so each Pauli matrix acts now on an individual copy of C2. We have 2L plus 1 copies of C2. So when you act somehow on a single spin at site X, you can extend the action of these Pauli matrices canonically to the whole Hilbert space by just tensoring the action of ones to these Pauli matrices. Okay, so this is a tensor product Hilbert space. We're defining operators on this tensor Hilbert space by telling you how they act on the individual components. Okay. Now, what is a Hamiltonian, namely a self-adjoint operator, which has some physical significance on such a tensor product Hilbert space? Well, since I think most of you are coming from the probability crowd, you've certainly somehow seen the Ising model. So the Ising model is in 1D would be a creature which you can think of somehow spins on a line, but these spins we have now values at each point of either being up or down. Now here we are talking about quantum spins, and their values are not just up or down. However, there's a basis in C2, there's an orthonormal basis in C2, which would be 1, 0. Let me call this up, and 0, 1, which is spin down. But that's not the only state this quantum particle can take, because we put the quantum particle in a state which is not one of those vectors in this orthonormal basis, but maybe somehow a linear combination of the two. Okay, so that's the difference between the Ising model of the model which I'm talking about. But from the Ising model, you're maybe familiar that what you want to look at is coupled spins. And the coupling typically is translation invariant, and it's a nearest neighbor interaction. Now, in quantum mechanics, the spins are then replaced by spin operators. Therefore, the spin operators are just up to factors of 1/2, these Pauli matrices. Okay, so that represents spin in direction 1, spin in direction 2, spin in direction 3. And when you think about somehow how an Ising model looks like, it would be a nearest neighbor spin-spin interaction. So the spin at side x interacts with the spin at side x plus 1. Well, since we don't only have sort of a z component, any of those three components can interact. They can interact with a coupling j alpha. And translation invariance would require that all of these couplings are independent of x. Okay, so that is a conventional quantum spin Hamiltonian, which, so to say, is a generalization of your favorite Ising model. Okay. Now, as in the Ising model, we can take these couplings, ferromagnetic or antiferromagnetic, corresponding to a plus positive coupling or negative coupling. Remember, in the Ising model, when you couple, for example, the three components, since I put an overall minus sign here, a positive coupling J3 would actually favor alignment of spins, and that is the phenomenon of ferromagnetism. Okay, whereas a negative coupling here, so J alpha being negative, would actually favor energetically that the spins are in opposite direction. Okay, now there's a zoo of quantum spin chains already for spin 1/2, which one can look at. The zoo basically corresponds to choosing different versions of these coupling constants. They all come with names. So there's a zoology of names. There's the XY chain, which is an abbreviation for taking the coupling in the three direction to be zero, and taking sort of generic non-zero couplings in the 1 and 2 directions, so what I will refer to in the following as a plane. There's the special case of the XY chain, which is the XX chain, where we require the in-plane coupling to be equal. So without loss of generality, I can set them 1. And then there's the XXZ chain, which is a generalization of the XX chain, where we switch on the coupling in the three direction in comparison to the XX chain. Okay. Now what I will focus on for simplicity in this talk will be these two quantum spin systems. Okay, now no randomness has been added. So let me now add randomness, and this can be done in various ways. A quantum spin glass would be a creature where you take these J alphas random. But let me be more conventional, and let me now add to this quantum Hamiltonian, to these quantum spins, an external magnetic field, which points in the three direction and which is random. Okay. Think about if you know the Ising model and how you would do this. Well, you would couple, oops, I forgot the random variables, omega x here, sorry. So there should be omega x up there. So multiply and we somehow the three component of the spin and we by omega x, sum over all lattice sites, and for simplicity, and since I want to do the same game as we've done in the case of the Anders model, we want to keep the distribution of the random variables fixed without loss of generality. Again, we somehow the single site distribution being absolutely continuous, compactly supported with a bounded density. We introduce a real parameter lambda, which is our disorder parameter, which we may switch off and we or just take positive. Okay. Now, what is the question which physicists are after? So basically, this model of the XXZ chain, where you take the J1 and J2 couplings equal to 1, and the J3 coupling and some other value, that's the XXZ chain now with a random magnetic field. And that's, in the physics literature, really a laboratory for the phenomenon of many-body localization. I brought you some references. Now, what is many-body localization? Well, the truth is, we're at a stage where there's actually no hard mathematical definition of this phenomenon. So physicists are still searching for a good definition. But let me bring to you, let me sort of talk about at least two definitions of this phenomenon of many-body localization. Okay. Okay, so remember what we proved in the one-particle system was that the eigenfunction correlator decayed, and that in particular entailed that the dynamics decayed exponentially. And this eigenfunction correlator can be viewed as a sign of correlations of the one-body eigenstates. Okay, now. So what physicists propose is that in a many-body situation, what should decay are likewise correlations. Now, what are many? How do you measure many-body correlations? Well, one of the simplest quantities which you can look at is you take local observables. Now, what are local observables? In the framework of quantum mechanics, a local observable would be just a bounded operator on my Hilbert space which models the individual quantum object, which in this case is a spin 1/2. So it's a bounded operator on C2. And then I can extend by tensoring once these local observables to the full Hilbert space. By positioning them at a site x and positioning b, for example, at a site y. Okay, then I can take the quantum time evolution of these observables. Now, so far we learned about quantum time evolution in the Schrödinger picture, where we time evolved wave packets, and there's a dual formulation of quantum time evolution, which is keeping the states fixed, but time evolving the observables. Okay, and this time evolution, the quantum time evolution for observables, would be the so-called Heisenberg dynamics, where the full Hamiltonian gives rise to at least in a finite dimension situation where we are to a unitary operator on our full Hilbert space, and you just unitarily evolve your local observables. That's the Heisenberg time evolution. And then, so for example, this observable A, it could measure whether the spin points in the three direction. What observable would we take? Well, we would take exactly. Oops, where is it? We would take. Oh, there's a minus sign missing, by the way. We would take exactly this observable here. Okay. And extend it in the canonical way to our Hilbert space. Okay, so you would ask, is the point, is it the spin at x pointing in the three direction by considering this observable AX is equal to sigma 3. And what is its correlation if we do, for example, if we the spin in the three direction and we pointing if we in another direction? Okay, so the time independent correlation and we would be then just taking the expected value of the product of these observables minus the product of the expectation values. And if you now consider time evolution, I mean, you would time evolve maybe one of those quantum observables, for example, maybe the 8th observable, then of course what will happen is that if you plug in sigma 3 here at location x, then the time evolution will create a non-local observable, right? Because it's a horribly complicated spin chain where if you apply it to a local observable, then even after an infinitesimally small time, what this beast will represent, it will represent a whole series of spin observables around the location x. Okay? Now, many body localization would be the phenomenon that when you take these observables spatially far apart, that even if you wait an arbitrarily long time, the quantum time evolution and we somehow cannot really reach up there. And the correlations and we would still decay exponentially in time. Okay. Now when I write expectation values, what kind of expectation values could I consider? Well, I could consider expectation values in any quantum state. So the quantum expectation value would be a trace in finite dimensions with a density matrix. So a density matrix is a non-negative operator which is normalized to be trace 1. Okay. And this could, for example, be just a pure many-body eigenstate. So just be some state normalized from my Hilbert space and be of n 2L plus 1 spins. Okay? It could also be a thermostate, and that's what you would look at in quantum statistical mechanics, where rho would be something like e to the minus inverse temperature h divided by, I have to normalize it, trace e to the minus beta h. Okay, so that would be a thermostate. Now what physicists claim, irrespective of whether you look at a thermostate or a many-body eigenstate, in these systems, at least at sufficiently large disorder, you will have the spatial decay of these correlations. Okay. Now, by the way, since I think you've probably never seen somehow these systems, let me ask you, in which situation would we immediately have even a total decorrelation of these quantities? Zero coupling, not zero Hamiltonian. I can still take the magnetic field, but spins in my spin chain, right? So I have a spin and we somehow minus L and we have a spin and we somehow at L and everywhere in between. If there's no coupling in between those spins, right, then the Hamiltonian itself, so if the J alphas are all equal to zero, then the Heisenberg dynamics of a local observable would be just equal to the effective dynamics on the individual component tensor 1, right? So what is H? Well, h in this case, or that is hx, would be just lambda or minus lambda over 2 times sigma 3 omega of x. Okay. So in this case, you would have somehow a trivial dynamics in the sense that local, the time evolution of local observables stay local. And also, if you take expectation values in, for example, the any many-body eigenstate or in the thermal state, these states, they would be product states because they inherit the product nature of our Hamiltonian in this case. Nothing is coupled. Right? So if everything is a product, then of course the expectation value of this product is just equal to this guy. So unless x is equal to y, you just have plain zero here. Okay. So in some sense, what the proposal which is behind looking at these correlations is you're measuring to which degree the Hamiltonian and its eigenstate retain the product nature which would be present if all interactions are switched off. Okay, so localization is not anymore localization in a position basis, but now it's the question of whether the eigenstates of this many-body Hamiltonian have actually are close to being a product state. That is what this definition or this requirement asks you to prove. Now here's even a more physical quantity, we are now dealing with fancy things like entanglement. Okay, so another quantity which is quite popular in looking at this in this community is the so-called bipartite entanglement entropy of many-body eigenstates, psi. So if you take just an arbitrary vector psi in this tensor product Hilbert space, you can perform the following question. Calculate the reduced state, so that would be p psi. Calculate the reduced state of this pure state p psi, of this one-dimensional projection. Now, what do I mean by reduced state? Okay, so think about this spin chain as being decomposed in a bipartite way of just carving out, we say, an interval of sides u and the complement of it. That's u complement. Now, how do you get the reduced state? what I mean by this symbol trace u complement of rho. So this is now an operator on the Hilbert space of the tensor product associated with a segment. Okay, and as such, I can describe it by giving you the matrix elements in my favorite orthonormal basis of this Hilbert space. Now, my favorite orthonormal basis in this Hilbert space would be a tensor product of this orthonormal basis in C2. Okay, so what would be somehow, so let me apply it to a state which is a combination of, let me call them little sigmas. And excuse for the second, my physicist notation. So sigma would be a vector of sort of ups and downs, which is just a shorthand for a tensor product basis composed of these basic vectors here. Okay, Now, what is this this reduced state? Well, by definition, it's the sum over where there's the tensor basis of the full Hilbert space. Okay, the full Hilbert space, I mean, you can describe it by tensoring omegas. So this would be sites in U, and omega would be a basis in U complement. Okay, so when you take the collection of U and U complement, you get a tensor product basis in the full Hilbert space. And what we do is we just take this state and calculate something which looks like somehow the trace. Okay, but the trace is only taken over spin configurations in U complement. Okay, so this is somehow what the symbol stands for. Now, these partial traces, something which your linear algebra teacher should have taught you, but probably didn't. They have, this is really just again pure linear algebra. They have a variety of properties. If you take a state, namely a row which is non-negative in trace one, then the partial trace will be a state on the reduced Hilbert space. So it will be still non-negative. It will still have trace one. Okay, that's somehow easy to see that it has trace one. Just take tau equal to sigma and sum over it. And then you get the trace of the full thing. And that was somehow set to one. Okay, so states are mapped to states and this operation of taking the reduced state. And now you can look at something which, as probabilists, you're well familiar with, namely at entropies of these states. Now, entropy somehow is usually you take the von Neumann entropy, but let me be a bit more fancy and introduce so-called Reni entropies. Now, what are Reni entropies? Well, for Reni entropies, you take the state rho u. This is now a non-negative matrix on this Hilbert space here. Okay, you take the alpha's power, that's well defined through the spectral representation. Alpha is being positive. You take the trace of this creature. You take the logarithm, and you multiply by 1 over 1 minus alpha. Okay, that is called the Reni entropy. Now, it's a not entirely straightforward exercise to prove that for any alpha being bigger than 1, these quantities are actually non-negative. So they are what at least physicists would perceive as the right sign of the entropy, namely the positive sign. Now, you might somehow get nervous about alpha being equal to 1. Now, here's a little exercise to you. I claim that when alpha goes to 1, this quantity actually has a limit. And indeed, the limit is the well-known von Neumann entropy. So S1 of u of the state psi, that is in fact equal to minus trace rho log rho, and it's the reduced state. Okay. Now remember, somehow what we're after in our first definition was a statement that these many-body eigenstates of the Hamiltonian are actually close to being product states. Now, what happens if I take a state rho, or a state psi, which is a product state, and I calculate the reduced state? Right, here's a little exercise for you. So if pi psi is equal to P of Cu tensor P of Cu complement, then the reduced state on U would be just P of Psi U. Okay? So if the state Psi, so this corresponds to the state Psi being equal to a tensor product of a state on U and U complement, then the reduced state is nothing else but the rank one projection onto that component which lives on U. Now, what is the entropy of a pure state? Okay, let's take this little exercise. You have a rank one projection. You take the alpha's power. What is this? That is equal to the same rank one projection by the spectral theorem. You take the trace of a rank one projection that's normalized to one. Right? The logarithm of one is zero, so the entropy is zero. Okay. So if the state would be a tensor product state, then you would measure by considering the Rényi entropy on any segment if you would measure the Rényi entropy of the reduced state, you would always get zero. Okay. Now, what do physicists propose? Well, it cannot be quite, somehow all our eigenstates of this system cannot be tensor products because we couple the spins. So the eigenstates won't be uncoupled. However, it is reasonable to expect that they're close to being that. And one way to measure closeness, which is different than measuring these correlations, is measuring actually the entropy of the reduced state. Now, if the entropy is positive and if it doesn't scale with the volume of the segment on which I consider the reduced state, but rather it only scales as the boundary of the volume of this segment, which in one dimension would be just two sides, then I'll call somehow the system of satisfying an area law. An area law in one dimension would be just saying that the Rényi entropy of the reduced state in fact stays bounded. Okay, so it's not anymore zero, but it stays bounded and it doesn't increase with the system size. That is another way of measuring correlations, in this case quantum correlations, which are present in these many-body eigenstates. Okay. Yes.
This is equivalent or close to saying that if we start at equilibrium, this entropy is the sum of the entropies.
Yes. Being a product, if the Hamiltonian would factorize, right, then of course the entropy of the total system would be the entropy of the sum of the entropies of the individual systems. However, here we don't have a complete factorization, and we want to say, what I'm measuring here, that's important. I'm measuring the entropy of a pure state, the reduced entropy of a pure state. So the full entropy of psi on the big system would be zero. So that's one of the wonders of quantum mechanics, right? You can have a state on a large system which has entropy zero, but then when I take the entropy of the reduced system, it is actually arbitrarily large. That is the essence of what is called the Alice Bob Bell inequality phenomena. That the entropy of a state on a segment can actually be much larger than the entropy of the state on the full system. Okay, so that's one of the essence of the wonders of quantum mechanics. It's a way of measuring entanglement in this quantum system. Okay, that's done by these Rainier entropies. Okay. Now, what physicists and me have also done, they're of course more ambitious than just considering the static area law, they consider somehow time evolution. Now, time evolution of eigenstates, that's boring, because if you take an eigenstate, then the time evolution is stationary. But you could perform the following experiment, and that's done numerically in quite a few papers. One of them I featured here, which is this U graph. You could take a state which is not an eigenstate of the system, but rather take a product state. So some state on U, some other state on the complement. So a state which is exactly as here on the blackboard. Consider the time evolution of the full system on that state. Now, of course, since our time evolution is generated by a Hamiltonian which couples the interior with the exterior, under time evolution, the product nature of this state will be destroyed. And therefore, you expect that the entropy of the reduced state at time t is not equal to zero. And typically, this would grow in sort of typical system. This would grow actually fast with t in a polynomial fashion. But in a random system, people measure numerically a very slow grow, which is proportional to the log of t. Okay, and that is what you can see somehow in the view graph. In the view graph, what you see is exactly the Rainier entropy corresponding to different values of alpha and actually different values of the initial state. And you see somehow this logarithmic growth of the Rainier entropy. Now, in the bottom here, what is depicted is exactly this quantity here, but for the XX chain, where we switch off the coupling in the three direction. And there you can see that it doesn't even grow logarithmically, but it saturates at a constant value. Okay, so the task is, can you understand this? Now, unfortunately, this turns out to be a sort of a complicated question. They are only very selected mathematically. Or let me put it as such, some of these works are not completely mathematically rigorous, but some of them are completely mathematically rigorous. Now, what have mathematicians done so far? Well, as you will see in a second, these quantum spin systems, they can be actually mapped to particle systems. People looked for quite a while actually at generalizing these proofs of localization from one particle to just a fixed, arbitrarily high number of particles. For one particle, somehow these are these old works, starting somehow in the late 2000s, we have somehow came up with a scheme of doing an induction of particle number. Unfortunately, we cannot reach the limit of arbitrary number of particles in an infinite system, because the localization lengths in this process diverge. Now, Imbri irgendwie somehow gave a sketch of a proof irgendwie of decay of correlations, something in which I flashed irgendwie on the previous transparency, irgendwie in certain one-dimensional spin chains, irgendwie this proof irgendwie is not entirely irgendwie rigorous, irgendwie it is a sketch of an argument irgendwie which might or might not work. There have been other works irgendwie on in another formulation, but as you will see, irgendwie somehow irgendwie this is close. Mastro Pietro irgendwie looked at ground state localization, and so what he took irgendwie is as psi being the ground state irgendwie of these systems, irgendwie now not spin systems but fermions, in fact irgendwie a potential where which is not random irgendwie but quasi periodic is the famous Aubry-André potential, and funnily he could actually push through irgendwie the decay of correlations, irgendwie at least for the ground state. Irgendwie there's a very nice work done here in Paris by Raphael Ducartes, which also contributed irgendwie to localization proofs for weakly interacting fermions, but not irgendwie for the full system, but in so-called Hartree-Fock theory. And what I will talk about is now works related to this body of papers, and we were. We looked at integrable models, which is the XY chain, as I will explain in a second, and non-integrable models in a particular phase of this non-integrable model, which is the XXZ chain. Okay, now let me go now to this XXZ chain and describe to you why this quantum spin system is in fact equivalent to a particle system. Okay. Now, instead of representing the spins on my line in my favorite basis, which is the eigenbasis of sigma 3, the joint eigenbasis of all sigma 3s, which I, as I said, somehow indicated by being spin up, that's this eigenvector, and spin down, that's this eigenvector. So the tensor product eigenbasis can be represented by this string of spin up and spin down. I can now tell you another story for this string, namely let me mark the position of the down spins. Okay, I mark them in this very particular spin configuration in red. And I will now call the position of the down spins as position of particles. Okay, so in this picture, we have a spin chain of length 13, and I have 7 spin downs, and that would correspond to 7 particles. Now, clearly, somehow there's a one-to-one correspondence of marking where the down spins are. And marking the positions of the particles. The positions of the particles are encoded in a vector x, where, of course, the first particle has to be before the second particle, before the third particle, and so on. So the configuration space of n of these n particles which emerge from this mapping is nothing else but the ordered n tuples on this segment of the real line. Okay. Now, as it turns out, somehow there's a unitary equivalence of the full Hilbert space to the direct sum of Hilbert spaces of n particles. I have to allow for no particle being present, because that would correspond to a spin configuration where all spins are up. That is n equal to 0 here. And of course, I have to allow for all particles being spin down, that would correspond to a particle configuration where n is equal to 2l plus 1 and everything in between. So there is this natural unitary equivalence of particle configurations and spin configurations encoded by this picture, and I can ask how does the XXZ chain now look in this particle representation. Okay, Now there's a little calculation which comes along with this, and surprisingly, once you unitarily transform the XXZ chain, you get on each of those sectors of a fixed particle number a Hamiltonian, which looks as the usual Hamiltonian. Namely, you have an adjacency matrix which just models hopping of the particles by one step. That is the term which came from the in-plane, the one and two interaction. Now, there's a term which measures interactions of these hardcore particles. Now, the interaction is, I should probably put up this picture again. The interaction is most easily described in this picture. Namely, the value of the interaction on this configuration, it's a multiplication operator, is just equal to half of the number of boundary terms where a spin down meets a spin up, multiplied by our coupling in the z direction. Okay. So this is this interaction potential. So it's half of the number of cluster boundaries in X, where the cluster is just a naturally defined through neighboring spin downs. So neighboring positions of particles. In this case, there would be three clusters in this configuration. Then our random magnetic field in the z direction, it turns out to transform to a random potential for those particles. Okay, so the random potential on a configuration X is just the sum of random variables where the particles sit. Now, as you somehow see, this is not exactly just the unitarily transform of the XXZ chain, but as usual, when you work with finite volume systems, you have to specify some boundary conditions, and convenient boundary conditions will be the so-called droplet conditions, where I'm adding a term to the Hamiltonian which prevents the spin downs to be actually glued to the boundary of my system. Okay, that's what this term here does. And its strength will be taken in proportional to the coupling in the three direction that is convenient so that the unitary transform of this Hamiltonian really works out as being a random Schrödinger operator on this particle configurations, which now have an interaction which is proportional to the number of cluster boundaries. And this works up to a constant, but remember, we're not interested in somehow energy shifts.
What is delta?
Oh, delta. Delta was somehow the very beginning here. Delta is the coupling strength in the three direction of my XXZ chain. Okay? Wonderful. Okay. Good. Now, it is a fact worth mentioning that in this unitarily equivalent, these operators here, their block diagonal in the decomposition of the full Hilbert space into particle numbers, that is because our original XXZ Hamiltonian in fact commutes with a total spin in the three direction, and the total spin in the three direction is just proportional to the particle number. So there is no term in this Hamiltonian. I didn't need to include a term in the Hamiltonian which involves particle creation and particle annihilation. So these operators act individually on the sums, block decompositions. Now, but still, sort of the basic message here is that this XXZ chain is really unitarily equivalent to an interacting random particle system. Okay, but in this a quantum system, maybe because I'm now considering a many-particle Schrödinger operator with an honest interaction as long as delta is strictly positive or non-zero. Okay. Now, these Hamiltonians, and we actually have a special structure, and it's worth switching off this interaction for a while and considering the case of the XX chain. Now, as it turns out, the case of the XX chain is integrable, and you switch off the intercluster interaction by switching off delta. Now, but remember, somehow in this system, in this particle system, there's still some sort of an interaction of particles present because you have a hardcore condition. Namely, the configuration space of particles is such that there can never be more than one particle on a lattice side. Okay? So you switch off the intercluster interaction by switching off delta, but you don't switch off the complete interaction. So the system is not, you may think the system is not entirely trivial. However, as it turns out, it is, and the remaining hardcore interaction may be removed by what is known in this community as a Jordan-Wigner transformation. So this Jordan-Wigner transformation works as follows, that you can associate to the spin operators on lattice sides other operators C in the following way, that you start from, say, the left end of the spin chain, attached to the left end the so-called spin annihilation operator, which is this combination of sigma 1 and sigma 2. And as you work your way up along the spin chain, you multiply products of sigma 3 to the spin annihilation operator. Okay, so that's just the definition. Now, the magic is that these sets of operators, which you define in such a way, they satisfy this, the canonical anti-commutation relations, so the algebra of creation and annihilation operators for fermions on the lattice. That is to say, the C anti-commutes with a C, so the curly brackets, I should probably say this, because... So this is the anti-commutator. So this is AB plus BA. Okay, the C's anti-commute with the C's, their adjoints anti-commute, and C dagger, they anti-commute to a delta, to a Kronecker delta. So they anti-commute at different lattice sites, they anti-commute at different lattice sites, but don't anti-commute on the same lattice site. Now, if you write out the full spin Hamiltonian in terms of these fermionic operators, then it, as it turns out, it's actually a quadratic form plus a constant. And the quadratic form is something which you recognize from the first part of the course, namely the matrix, which is associated to the vectors of the creation and annihilation operators is, in fact, your good old one-dimensional Anderson model on this segment. Okay, so what do we know about the Anderson model? Well, we know that the eigenfunction correlator decays exponentially and that there's dynamical localization. I didn't prove it completely in one dimension, but at least at high disorder, you know how to prove this now. Now, the task is, for example, to understand what the correlations in this model do. So what you can look at is the first challenge, namely the decay of correlations. For that, you take a local observable A, put it on lattice side X, you take a local observable B, put it on lattice side Y, time evolve one of them, take just a normalized eigenfunction of the XX chain, and compute your correlations. Now, because everything is random, of course, this correlation is now also random. So it's useful to consider the expected value of these correlations. And what we could prove in a paper with Robert Sims in 2016 is that indeed if we some of this dynamical localization of the one-dimensional Anderson model implies that all these local correlation functions, they do decay, and they do decay in the very strong uniform way that even if you take a supremum over all normalized eigenfunctions along the supremum over t, the expected value still decays exponentially in the separation of these local observables. Now, the proof is a bit lengthy, but to the very core, what you have to do is you have to express these time-dependent correlation functions of local observables in terms of quantities of your one particle and the one-dimensional Anderson model. Now, how does that work? This is not entirely trivial, because when you take a local observable, like one of those spin variables, of course, when you re-express this in terms of your fermionic observables, since this Jordan-Wigner transformation is something which is utterly non-local, remember we multiplied somehow a bunch of operators in order to get these fermionic annihilation operators here. These quantities, when expressed in terms of the fermionic creation and annihilation operators, will be highly non-local, and therefore it won't be just a fermion correlation function. It will be a bunch of fermions multiplied together, and this you have to control. Now, as it turns out, somehow in the system, since this is a quadratic system, everything can be expressed in terms of Pfaffians of basic two-point correlation functions in the Anderson model. So the only deal which you have to go through is to understand why a Pfaffian decays once the entry decay. And that is, of course, in general not true, but these Pfaffians in itself, they have a particular structure, and that's what helped me to push through this result. Okay. So there's also a result by Abdulrahman, Nachtergale, Sims, and Stolz of the same year, which answered the second question, namely the question about the entanglement entropy. But let me not somehow put this up. Now let us go back to the XXC chain, because this is now somehow a model which is non-integrable, so it cannot be mapped to free fermions, namely a fermionic Hamiltonian which is quadratic in the annihilation and creation operators, but rather you have an honest interaction in this particle system, not just a hardcore interaction in one dimension. Now every configuration in this spin system, in this particle system, can be decomposed in clusters. Okay. So for example, the configuration which I had on my previous slide looked about like that. In this case, you have three clusters. And if you have n particles, you can obtain only all configurations by just taking the union of the configuration, which are consisting of exactly k clusters. These are denoted by ck. Now remember, the interaction for k clusters is actually constant in this set, namely the interaction potential. It's just multiplication by k on a k-clustered configuration. So what we want to understand is the spectral structure and the properties of eigenfunctions of this many particle Hamiltonian, which I put up again on this slide. This is an adjacency operator which describes one-step hopping of the individual particles. This is my cluster interaction and this is the random potential, which is common to all of these particles. So this operator acting just on the Hilbert space of a fixed particle number n. Now, let's talk for the second about what happens if one switches off the random potential. Now, once I switch off the random potential, the spectral structure of this Hamiltonian is actually quite well understood. And in particular, something which you can easily see is that if I go down to the subspace of L2, which consists of k clusters or more, then the energy of this Hamiltonian is bounded by the number of clusters which you have. And in case delta is actually greater than 1, and that is what is called the easing phase of this Hamiltonian, so delta being positive increases or makes the spins more likely to be aligned in the three direction. Okay, and delta being strictly bigger than 1, it makes the system more and more easing-like. And that's why this is called the easing phase. And as you see, somehow, in the easing phase where delta is greater than 1, if you decompose your configuration space into clusters, if you have a high number of clusters, this is energetically disfavored. Linearly in K. Okay, now I brought you somehow numerical simulations and dating back to a paper by Nachtergale and Starr, where I just shamelessly copied the view graph from. This structure of the spectrum in case we switch off the randomness. Okay, in fact, where do we know all this from? At least in the infinite volume limit, there's another magic tool which is good to learn about, which is the so-called Bethe-Ansatz, with which you can actually compute the full many-particle spectrum of this Hamiltonian. Okay. Now, in finite volume, this Bethe-Ansatz, as you probably know, doesn't work quite as well. That's why one needs to resort to a bit of numerics, and that was done in this paper. And here's the view graph of how the spectrum looks in the easing phase. Now, what should we take away from this view graph? Well, if I fix the number of particles, then there is a band for all n separated from the rest of the system, which corresponds to just having one macroscopic cluster of size n. And because remember, we have a bound on energy which tells you that energetically all eigenstates which come from two or more clustered configurations are energetically disfavored by this factor k 2 times delta minus 1. Okay? And there you see somehow the clear energy gap which separates a configuration of just one cluster from a configuration from the configurations from the eigenstates which intuitively correspond to more clustered configurations. Okay. Now, let me stress that this band, although in this view graph it looks like that there's just a single eigenstate, that is in fact not true. There's a full band of eigenstates, so they do have, if we resolve this band, a higher multiplicity. Okay. There are actually formulas for how large this droplet band can be in terms of the interaction in the z direction. Okay, but that's sort of irrelevant. What is most relevant for us is that you have this interval of states which is clearly separated from the rest of the spectrum where the so-called droplet states of this Hamiltonian live. Now, this is the states which I want to focus on. So intuitively, you can think of these states as being composed of mainly as in the position representation of states which are living on just purely clustered configurations. Bear in mind that, of course, this is just a picture, because this is a quantum Hamiltonian, the presence of the Hopping term requires that these product eigenstates are, of course, not exact eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. Okay, so this is just a picture of what I'm presenting here. Now, so there's a bit of a cheat in me which I want to do, and I admit it openly, but that's the best one can do at the moment. So what I want to do now, what I want to focus is a system where I'm adding to this spectrum here a random term, but with a particular kind of randomness, namely that the random potential is in fact non-negative and compactly supported. Now what happens to the spectrum intuitively if I add a non-negative random potential? Well, see, everything is shifted up, but the good thing is that the clustered configurations, they still remain energetically separated from the configurations which have two clusters or more. Okay, because if I add a non-negative term in the Hamiltonian, the energy estimate on the Hamiltonian projected to two or more clusters, and we will just get worse. Right, but nevertheless, since I allow the random potential to take arbitrarily small values, I still have states below this threshold. Right, because the random potential, since the omegas can take arbitrarily small values, the random potential can have arbitrarily large voids where I can accommodate a macroscopic droplet. Okay. So the bottom of the spectrum is certainly one of the things to bear in mind is that the bottom of the spectrum is certainly below above the one cluster threshold, and we saw above what we get for the non-random system, where you add the value of the random potential at least to a minimum value, the minimum of the overall clustered configurations. Now, but that has an important consequence, and that's really where our cheat is. That's why the system somehow becomes very much analyzable. Now, here's something, here's an exercise for the probability audience. When you take the value of the random potential over all clustered configurations, what kind of values can Vmin take? See, the omegas are supported in here. Let's suppose this is an equidistribution. Well, as I said, somehow the minimum value will be zero, right? Because all of these random variables could potentially be very close to zero. However, what is the typical value of this sum? These are IID random variables. And we have hardcore particles, so the XIs are all different. What is the typical value of this sum? Have we woken up? Wait, it's order n, right? Because it's a sum of n independent random variables. They have a mean, which is non-negative, and the typical value will be n times that mean. Okay, so the typical value of this guy will be of order n. So let me switch back to this view graph. So if I add somehow a value of order n to states in the droplet band, where we'll end up is somewhere up here on top of the mountain. Right, so that's the typical value. But there will be large deviations in this random potential. We have these large voids, where the value of the minimum irgendwie on clustered configurations simply will be order one or smaller. So I will have states irgendwie filling up this gap here. Okay. However, these states irgendwie are large deviations of this random potential, and since they are large deviations, I can actually say something about the local behavior of the local density of states in an interval which is of size order one. So what is the behavior of the local density of states? That's a quantity in which for one particle, and we've talked about yesterday. So that's the spectral projection now of this many-particle Hamiltonian taken in the position representation of the particles in its expected value. And I claim irgendwie that this is exponentially suppressed irgendwie for any interval of order one. Why is that true? I have a bit of a problem with the time, but let me nevertheless irgendwie somehow give you an idea of the proof. So how would you do this? Well, see, irgendwie one cool method irgendwie of estimating spectral projections is to, at the bottom of the spectrum, is to actually employ semigroup methods. See, by the spectral representation, this is nothing else but the indicator function on I of the spectral measure associated with x, dE. Right? But the indicator function that's bounded from above by an exponential. Well, an exponential is somehow modified by e to the t times the supremum, times this value here. Right? So this can be bounded from above by e to the t times the supremum times the integral with respect to the spectral measure of e to the minus te. But that is nothing else, if you again use the spectral theorem, the semigroup associated with this Hamiltonian. Now, but you now have a Schrödinger semigroup. What do we do for Schrödinger semigroups? Well, we employ the Feynman-Katz formula. So what does the Feynman-Katz formula do? The Feynman-Katz formula, for the lattice, but who cares, represents somehow this matrix element of the Schrödinger semigroup in terms of a Brownian motion, actually a Brownian bridge, so these are Brownian paths which start at x and really return to x of e to the potential, the total potential. Now the total potential is a sum of only two terms. So there's the random potential, and there's the interaction potential. Okay, so that's roughly the form of this probabilistic representation of my semigroup. And now, one of the nice things which you can do is you can actually estimate. This is now a conventional integral, and you can now estimate things. Since W is non-negative, maybe we can just throw it out, right? We want an upper bound. what do we want? No, let me not throw it out for the moment, actually. It's a bit of a silly idea. Let me not throw it out. But what we want to do is we want to compute an expected value on the whole thing. So take expectation values on the whole thing, and we now take expectation value on just the random potential. Now this is still sort of hard to compute. However, there's a neat trick in the Feynman-Katz representation, which is worth remembering, namely that you have an average up here, which you can pull down using Jensen's inequality. Okay, so by means of Jensen's inequality, we can pull down the average, the time average, there's a t here, and then we have this. But now you just evaluate the random potential MV at one configuration. So this is nothing else MV but the sum MV of the random variables associated MV to the lattice side MV where this Brownian motion passes at time s. And this expectation MV can be computed. Right? It's just an expectation value of e to a sum of independent random quantities. That can be done. And of course, MV somehow, MV this is of the order of t times n. Okay, and now MV you take MV somehow just some value of t, and you see MV somehow that the whole thing is bounded MV by a positive constant MV times n. Okay. So that's the trick in which you can employ in order to see that the local density of states of this many particle system is in fact exponentially suppressed for large number of particles. That is nothing surprising, as I said, because when you think about what's the typical value of the random potential it's order in. Now, what quantity are we looking at? Surprise, surprise, I mean, we're looking at exactly the quantity I mean, which you want to look at I mean, in the one-particle setup. I mean, namely, you look at the many-particle eigenfunction correlator. So you take configurations of particles, you take a spectral interval, and you just sum over the moduli of the spectral projections. It just perfectly generalizes what we've seen in our previous lectures. Of course, this quantity, and we just by means of a Cauchy-Schwarz, which you will also have on your exercise sheet, is bounded by. Whoops, that's actually not quite true. I mean, it's bounded in expectation value. It would be bounded by the XX matrix element. And otherwise, you would have to put a square root and the same quantity with Y here. And therefore, I mean, once you take an expected value of this quantity, it's typically exponentially smaller by the estimate, which we've just proven here with the help of the Feynman-Katz formula. Now, let me flash somehow what we can prove for this quantity. We cannot only prove that it's exponentially bounded, this we've seen, but we can also prove that it decays in the distance of this particle configuration. Now, the decay in this distance is encoded in terms of a function f, which at first sight looks horrendous, but it's actually a very easy function. So let me just tell you somehow what this function f is in particular situations. Now, if x and y are clustered configurations, so beasts of that form, which is just one cluster considering of four particles, and you want to know what's the decay of this particular cluster to that particular cluster in green, then the decay rate which we predict is in fact given by the distance of these two clusters, and the distance of the clusters is measured in terms of the distance of the locations of the first particle. Okay, so this is the decay which we get for clustered configurations with this horrendous formula. Now, what you get for general configurations, here is a view graph of what this sort of signals. Namely, if you're not on the manifolds of clustered configurations, so think of somehow the space of all configurations of particles as containing a manifold of clustered configurations. And if you're not on the manifold of clustered configurations, what f does, it actually gives you the distance which requires you to take the shortest path to the clustered manifold, and then just take an underground line to the point which connects to the shortest path to the clustered configuration from y. Okay? So the distance of x to y would be symbolically something of that sort, where the distance on of the clustered manifold is in fact just the full L1 distance of particles. Remember, I mean, the distance of particles, I mean, one of what was contained in here on one of my previous slides, I mean, that is in fact just naturally measured by the sum of distances of all the particles contained in the configuration. Okay, so of the clustered manifold, you get actually a much stronger decay than on the clustered manifold. Now, let me in the remaining 3 minutes and we talk a bit about somehow what this entails and how this is done. Now, this is a very detailed information on how the eigenstates of the many particle system, at least in the regime of energies where we can prove such an estimate, and that's the regime of energies which is basically below the band of two clustered configurations in the non-random system. Okay, so its energy is somehow below the threshold of 4 delta minus 12. It's a bit below that, but not much below that. We can prove that the eigenfunctions have this particular structure, that most of the eigenfunctions live on the clustered manifold. And even on the clustered manifold, the clustered configurations are stuck in terms of the natural distance of two clusters. And once they live on the unclustered manifold, or on the unclustered part of the configuration space, everything is exponentially suppressed towards the clustered configurations. So typical many-body eigenstates, they will have a large overlap with clusters. And the clusters themselves will be localized. That's the essence of this theorem. Now, typically in many particle systems, one does not have such a detailed information of how many particle eigenstates look like, because you cannot just calculate things. So typically, what people do and what they look at numerically are reduced quantities. Right, it's like, as a probabilist, if you want to keep track of a probability distributions on 1,000 parameters, that's something which you sometimes don't want to keep track of. If you're a statistician, you want to keep track of just the parameters which you want to focus on, which might be 3 or so. So you consider the reduced probability distribution. And asking about these correlations in quantum system is a bit like asking about the reduced distribution. Now, what we can do is take the reduced density matrix, so just focus on one particle configuration. So you take a position on the lattice psi, a position on the lattice eta, and you take your density operator and trace out over all particles aside from one. So you require that in the particle configuration x, there's a particle at psi. In the particle configuration y, there's a particle at 8. That's called the reduced density matrix. And using the previous expression on f, one can actually prove that the reduced density matrix of any normalized eigenstate which contains n particles, that decays exponentially in the distance of where you ask where these particles are, and it even decays exponentially in the particle number. Okay, you now may wonder what is the normalized eigenstate corresponding to eigenvalue E? Well, it is provable here that the spectrum is almost truly simple. So there is just one normalized eigenstate which you can associate to so eigenprojection which you can associate to this state. Now, this translates exactly to those spin correlation functions, and in the paper which I mentioned at the beginning, which also proves some of that, they nicely illustrate how you can go from these quantities here to the quantities simply which I flashed up on my slide, I mean, namely that you ask about at least static spin-spin correlation functions in their exponential decay. Now, I think I have about 2 minutes before flashing the proof strategy. So see, this looks like sort of infinitely remote from what I talked about in my previous two talks, but it's actually not. What you do here is you actually combine a standard fractional moment analysis for localization for the natural object which screams at you in this problem. Namely, so let's talk about two particles. So let me give you a proof by picture. If this would be just two particles, the configuration space would be x1, x2, and x2 would be bigger than x1, so we're living above the diagonal. Okay. Now the clustered configurations are the ones which are somehow close to the diagonal. That's the clustered manifold here. And what you essentially want to prove is that the system of two particles, which you can view as just one particle with two coordinates now, that once you take somehow some configuration x, that it decays to the other configuration y. Now, suppose you have an excuse why, if you go from x to the clustered configurations, things decay exponentially. Then you can think of this problem as somehow reducing to the case that x and y are on the clustered manifold. Now, but if x and y are on the clustered manifold, it's really just one cluster. That's like one particle moving. Right? So you try to prevent the movement of this monster particle, which consists of n particles, which moves like a train track. Now, how did we learn to prove localization? Well, once you are here, right, if I have an excuse why it decays here and decays here, once I'm here, then I can start a path expansion. Well, this path expansion will somehow take me away from the clustered manifold. But if I have an excuse, why somehow this doesn't matter, that these are, once I'm away from the clustered manifold, I in any way decay, the only thing which I have to prevent is that things move in such a way. Right? Now, but notice the following, that one of those things which drove people mad in the analysis of many particle systems is that, in fact, the number of random variables which you have in this system is very low in comparison to the number of lattice sites. In the one particle Anderson model, is if you consider a graph, if you had that many random variables. Here, if you have somehow two particles, the random variable at that site will influence all configurations which are on that cross. Right? So you get sort of awful correlations if you start any path expansion. However, if you start the path expansion in this direction, you refresh your environment. So you can sort of start trying to integrate out in a similar way as what I showed you in the one particle situation. And that's in fact what we do. So the proof is somehow a two-step strategy. You create an excuse why moving away from the clustered manifold doesn't matter. That is technically a bound which mathematical physicists know, at least in the one particle setup. That's called a Comte-Thomas bound. A Comte-Thomas bound in general is a bound which tells you that, well, my Green's function, so in the one particle setup, my Green's function, if I'm away from the spectrum, it generically decays exponentially at least if the distance of z to the spectrum of h remains bigger than delta. Okay, so that's a Comte-Thomas bound. These people knew how to prove. Now, here, things are a bit more involved, because in these Comte-Thomas bound, if you look at them, the way this is proven, if you have a lattice which has a large number of neighbors, and that's true if we are actually in an n-particle configuration space, the number of neighbors grows with n, then all of these bounds which you can obtain from the classical literature deteriorate. So you have to do something different, but decomposing the full configuration space in terms of these segments which contain at least k clusters, and you can start an induction and prove nevertheless that the Green's function, even on the real axis, once you restrict to the Hilbert space of two or more clusters, this is exponentially decaying in the L1 distance. Even on the real axis. Why even on the real axis? Because you know that this Hamiltonian doesn't have spectrum there. So that's why I'm calling this a Comte-Thomas bound. So this prevents somehow the expansions moving too far away from the clustered manifold, and on the clustered manifold have an effective one particle problem. And this I can deal with by the type of methods which I talked about in my previous two talks. Okay. Now, how do you go in this situation from decay of Green's function to decay of the eigenfunction correlators? Well, that's something which Michael Eisenman and I learned to do somehow in our papers on n-particle localization. Okay, I think I should stop here and I'll probably not talk about how to prove the other result, namely that there's an area law for the system. And in fact, the time-dependent entanglement entropy is uniformly bounded in a very strong way. You can even calculate exponential moments, and they are uniformly bounded. So this is a regime where everything which the physicists so far looked at in the XXZ chain is quite different to what we are looking at. And that's because mainly we don't have any states available before the particle to live at. Okay, maybe I should just flash the references to these papers that if you want to read more about this, there's a paper which just appeared this year in Annales Henri Poincaré, where indeed the proof of this droplet localization in the XXZ chain is written up. Thank you very much.
Any questions in this last lecture?
Are there any perspective on higher dimensional quantum spin change?
Okay, so see, somehow basically, this type of system, for the very reason that the interaction in this particle system is attractive, it forces things to cluster. And it separates the states which are clustered from the non-clustered configuration, and therefore effectively reduces the problem to an effective one-particle problem. You can think of as also as treating in higher dimensions. Then the question of somehow what is a cluster, and maybe you have to define clusters in a bit of a more relaxed way of saying that it's exactly sort of spins sitting next to each other, but just being sort of close to each other and having a large overlap. That could potentially be done. See, I can also define sort of as an XXZ chain in higher dimension and going to the regime where I have an attractive interaction. And I believe this is potentially doable of treating this regime. However, let me emphasize that this is not what you really want to do as a physicist, because this is a very special system. We are in a regime where there are hardly any states. The question effectively reduces to a one particle question for a compound particle, which in quantum mechanics is sort of a bit hard to define, but this is doable here. That's not what you really want to ask about. What you really want to ask about is a regime where there are many states, and nevertheless, you have all this phenomena which I talked about, namely decay of correlations, decay of the entanglement entropies, in a situation where the states are not rare. That is, in some sense, what physicists are predicting, which would totally contradict any ergodic hypothesis in statistical mechanics. But that's extremely far away. For that, presumably, the best shot which you have is looking at the paper by Imbri and trying to make this rigorous, this scheme. It's a renormalization scheme, which is much more based on the multiscale analysis. Yes.
All the results you mentioned were for delta bigger than one.
Yes, and only for the droplet regime, only at the very bottom of the so it's ground state localization, in this very special system.
For smaller smaller delta.
No, nothing works because. Essentially, as I said, I set up a system which is ever so slightly cheating so that I can go back to a quasi one particle analysis. If I want to do more, if I want to consider that is what Rosen et al., for example, where they do their numerics, I would love to treat the Heisenberg chain, right? The Heisenberg chain would be delta equal to one. That would be the Heisenberg point where the system is sort of totally rotational invariant. Now, let me warn you, it's not completely clear, and I think there are very good reasons to believe that many-body localization is not true in higher-dimensional interacting systems. It's probably a phenomenon which is bound to one-dimensional systems. But that's not even clear and debated among the physicists. So. So this is really one of those situations where you're working on a front where you don't quite know what's true.
Any other question? No more. So let's thank Simone again.